I think we've gone live, and so we today have a very interesting session lined up for you, and with very senior people from the industry joining us. So this is the panel today that we're going to discuss is addressing media quality and brand safety in India. This has been presented by Exchange for Media in association with Double Verify. So with proliferation of digital media channels and platforms, media quality has become a top concern for advertisers in India. This has been particularly true during the COVID-19 pandemic, as consumers are increasingly depending on digital sources for information. Rather than just focusing on campaign metrics such as reach or conversions, brands and advertisers are placing further importance on where their content is appearing. To do so, advertisers are adopting brand safety suitability tools to stay away from objectionable websites and apps or from content that promotes misinformation or hate speech. With me today are very senior people from the industry. I would start in, I think this is in alphabetical order. Please welcome Mr. Arvind RP, Director Strategy, Marketing, Digital and Communications, McDonald's. Hello. Then we have Ms. Divya Karani, CEO, Dentsu Media South Asia. Then we have Nichiket Deol, Head of Sales India, Double Verify. Ms. Ruchira Jaitley, Head of Marketing, Product Portfolio and GTM India. Mr. Vishal Jacob, Chief Digital Officer, Wavemaker. A very warm welcome to all of you, and thank you so much for taking out time for our discussion today. I hope I pronounced your names correctly, and if I didn't, apologize. Forgive me. So we can start with our first question. I would like to start with, you know, either Divya or Vishal, or maybe Divya first. You know, as I mentioned in the intro, that now we have so many digital media channels and platforms, and media quality has become a top concern for advertisers in India. You know, quality means that ads are fully viewed by real person in a brand safe environment within the intended geography. Of all the components of media quality, with brand safety, fraud, viewability, and NGO, which is the most important to you and the biggest concern for the industry?
All. And rightly so, these qualitative parameters in very many ways need to become table stakes for the health and growth and trust of the entire digital ecosystem. And if all of us who are quite close to the digital ecosystem were to step back and look at the entire media ecosystem, you will find parallels being drawn and replete in our history within the media ecosystem. The good news is there is a growing positivity and responsibility of the entire system. Marketeers are now deploying both brand safe and brand suitable verifications to ensure that the brands support responsible media. And this, to my mind, is, you know, like I said, hygiene. So it is vital that we keep ad fraud, viewability concerns at bay. But these are it's just the beginning. It's table stake for the vitality of this industry. So I would not go with choosing one over the other. All are and hygiene. That's it.
But what are the bigger concerns that you hear from your clients? I mean, if there's any particular thing which you get to hear more often.
It's across. So you see, it's not what the point, the limited point is, it's not either or, right? Brand safety, brand suitability have come to the fore perhaps a little more in the recent past than the earlier. Fraud and viewability and NGO and all were always there, right? But because of very many reasons, the way our media ecosystem, what we have faced in the last 1 year or 18 months, the other two have come to the fore. Do we need to address both of them, and are we doing so? Capital, yes. Does that mean our attention goes away from the others? No. So, you know, and I would imagine just when you address these, there will perhaps be a couple more as we walk along. But for the health of this ecosystem, the acid test will be when it's no longer a topic of conversation and it is taken as rigor that is there across all. That is my point.
Jacob. Vishal.
I wish we had the liberty of picking one or two, and I agree with Divya, it's not possible to do so because they're kind of interconnected, you see, right? So just to give you some context, if you look at India as a country, right, and basically if you look at the kind of investment that's actually going on ad fraud as well as on, brand safety or suitability, a good amount of that is happening at the impression level, which means it's happening at the exposure level, right? Almost 90% of that, more than 90, in fact, of that is happening at the exposure level. But when you look at ad fraud, actually, it happens through the entire consumer journey, right? So impression, just one of them, right? So there's fraud that happens at an impression level, there's fraud that happens at a click level, there's a fraud that happens at a visit level, there's a fraud that happens at a leads level. Maybe there won't be any frauds at a sales level, but, all the way down to sales, you'll find, fraud happening across the entire consumer journey. So I don't think we can necessarily pick one or two areas, and if you really want to give justice to the entire campaign as such, I don't think it's possible to pick one or two and say this is more important than the other. And just so you know, essentially, if you look at, again, I was just reading this report on the bad fraud report, which gets published every year, right? And it's very alarming to note that of every 100 people coming onto a website, only 50% of them are actually human traffic. Remaining 50% are bots. And that there are good bots and bad bots. And if you look at the bad bots, essentially they're close to 30% of the traffic on a website on any URL, whether it's vishaljacob.com or xyz.com, basically. 50% of that is on bots and 30% is on bad bots. And that 30% has been growing 6% in the last, if you take the cumulative average growth in the last 3-4 years, it's been growing at 6-7%. So that's very alarming, right? So long story short, essentially, I think if you want to give justice to an entire campaign, I don't think we can necessarily separate and say this is more important than the other. I think it's very critical to look at every single element and see what's it doing to your business. And if you really want to give justice to that, then you're going to look at it from a holistic view.
Thank you. I'm really sorry. I missed introducing Mr. Sriram Padmanabhan, VP Marketing, Nissan Motors, India Private Limited. I'm extremely sorry, Mr. Sriram. You're most welcome to the panel. And it was my bad. So I would now want to start from you. The next question is for Mr. Sriram. Brand marketers, do you agree on the above, what these two agency, senior agency people have just told us? And as we continue to navigate the effects of the pandemic and the evolving news cycle in 2021, how has that affected your media buying and practices?
So that's a very big question.
Should I break it into two? I mean, we can start with, first part, that do you agree with what Divya and Vishal just told us?
Yeah, no, I can take, I think, absolutely. I think brand safety and suitability are extremely critical. From where I operate, our job is to sell automotive. And my job as a marketer is to get inquiries into my dealership so that they can inquire and convert. Now, in the past, almost 70% of my funds were getting spent around TV and print and those kind of what we call as above the line media, traditionally. I think now digital has become above the line. Almost 36% of our media spend is on digital. And it's really critical for us to make sure that not only the content, but the quality is measured in terms of where this content is viewed and how it's getting viewed along with what kind of media is it getting viewed, so that when they come into my brand website, they're getting a good level of engagement. We measure bounce backs, CTRs, impressions. We measure right down to from a UTM level to understand what level of conversions we have. I won't be able to make those conversions work, my cost per sale work, unless I am making sure that all my ads have the hygiene level of brand safety and suitability. And now it's much easier, like Vishal and Divya are saying, it is still not as evolved as in other markets, but definitely, we're getting there, with players like Nachiket and, Double Verify, definitely, things are getting easier.
Ruchira, would you want to add to that?
I agree with Divya. You know, when she said that, I started laughing because that's exactly when I saw that question. I said, how is this an either or kind of a question? For me, there are all kinds of risks today that we have to navigate. I think the fact is that the media environment that we used to operate in even 10 years ago was a sanitized one, relatively speaking, right? It was scrubbed for a lot of these concerns because you placed your ad in an environment, you knew when it was coming, how long it was running, and was pretty much done. So sanitized, right? The worst case scenario could have been, and I remember this happened to us one World Cup, where India exited early, so you kind of wondered whether anyone's going to watch your ad. So, you know, the viewability of the tournament pretty much impacted. Now look at where we are, and let's look at what happened last year with COVID. You know, that was your question as well, right, Nazia?
Yeah.
What happened with COVID is, and we were an industry that, by the way, was maybe on, had an easier ride, because everyone was looking for devices and connecting, and, you know, a lot of the themes that we would otherwise want to talk about were very relevant. But in an environment where, you know, you cannot or you do not get the right sentiment or the right visual and video analysis, the brand risk actually would considerably go up, particularly with video, particularly with fake news that was proliferating and the higher video consumption that was happening pretty much across channels, right? So video as a format lends itself to a fair amount of risk, and then you have a high consumption environment. And in that environment, it is relevant to speak to people on digital, particularly on mobile, which in India is the lead medium. We don't even talk about desktop, right? So now look at what you've compounded, because mobile is that much tougher as a medium on which to talk on. I think as a business, really, for us, while the relevance was without doubt, but our ability to therefore find the right context in which we would want to even put out any media was very, very important. Sentiment, of course, really important. I mean, let's take a worst case scenario. Talk about connecting people, and you'll end up placing yourself next to someone's memory of someone who's maybe, you know, not around anymore. That's the worst thing you could do, right, to someone. So, and I'm using that as a case. I mean, I don't think that ever happened to us, and I hope to God that it didn't, but it was fraught with risks. In that environment, how does an agency partner hold your hand through it? And of course, we work with Wavemaker, and Vishal's right here. So we're all on the same side. We, of course, we work on reputational risks, on hate crimes, on alcohol, on adult content, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I mean, it goes way beyond that. It's gone beyond those basic hygiene keywords, blacklisting words, et cetera. It's gone way beyond that to say, where is your ad being seen and how contextually relevant is it or not? For me, that's a larger piece that's got, you know, not, I'm not saying that fraud's not important, et cetera. But for me, all of that's hygiene, table stakes in an environment where we're spending so much money in this environment. So this conversation, this discussion, I hope to learn a lot from people like, you know, Arvind, Sriram, from Divya, from Michal, and of course, from Ajit, because I think this is something that we all need to know far more about. I don't think anyone's got that perfect solution yet, but maybe Arvind, someone does on this discussion.
Arvind, if I can have you in now, I mean, we would first want to start with the question that I'd asked before, and then I can ask another question to you.
So, yes, I totally agree with the other panelists. This is a very, very complex issue. And if anything, is getting more complex with time. In the context of McDonald's, yes, there is a whole aspect of brand campaigns, right? Where you measure viewability, where you measure brand safety. And especially given that we are a family-focused brand, brand safety online is a very, very critical issue as far as we are concerned. And then because of with our food delivery business, and food delivery business, like other e-commerce, categories have really grown in the last few years, and for which we kind of invest quite significantly in customer acquisition online. And that's where the whole question of ROI comes, right? And we have discovered that, adopting many, many advanced practices as far as limiting ad fraud goes, your ROI significantly goes up from your investments in terms of orders. So there's two aspects to it, brand safety and as far as ROI focused efforts. And also, so I don't want to make this issue more complex than it already is, but you also have the issue of humans acting as bots, right, online today, right? Take Twitter an example. And while today it's largely in the political sphere and little bit in the brand sphere, you can see this being spreading throughout the whole digital ecosystem, where where an army of so-called influencers are sitting and making stuff viral. So from a brand perspective, what is authentic engagement, right? That's always the question. That's always the worry. And of course, doing it the right way. And like Sriram mentioned, the investments on digital are only increasing, right? And so, for example, today 40% of our spends are on digital, which means it's a responsibility of marketer to kind of prove that you're doing it in the right way, brand safe way, as well as providing the best ROI.
But if you could answer the particular question that how has this affected media buying practices?
So let me put it this way. It is definitely not a barrier or a concern when it comes to investing on digital. We feel that's the future, like the others in the panel have already spoken. But we have to do it with a lot more caution and a lot more measurability. Which means investments in tools, techniques, a lot of manual effort to make sure we're just tracking the digital campaigns carefully, to get better ROI and better brand safety. So I would say it is not influencing the quantum of investments, but definitely influencing the way we are looking at digital even more closely than we did before, just to make sure we are doing things right.
Thanks, sir. So before I move to my next question, I want to remind audiences that we will be opening the floor for Q&A in another, let's say, like 20, 25 minutes. Like, last 15 minutes would be for audience Q&A. So please keep sending your questions. So next, I want to bring Nachiketh into the debate. And, this was also part of the previous question. How does advertising against inflammatory content with misinformation and hate speech affects a brand's reputation?
So if you look at it, inflammatory content on hate or hate speech per se is something that we've seen recently, but that's not the limit of the content, right? That's not the only content which harms a brand's reputation, right? There is a plethora of other content, like be it violence or disaster, be it terrorism, adult content, right? All these contents also are equally harmful. And it does affect brand's reputation, right? And I completely echo what Divya and everybody else said at the beginning with your first question, right? It's not only about brand safety, right? Media quality should comprise of all four or five components, right? It needs to be a brand safe, plus it needs to be viewable, plus it needs to be fraud-free, and plus it needs to be NGO, which is a hygiene practice for marketers today. But on-ground reality, because we have these conversations day in, day out, right? A lot of marketers still say that, hey, I'm looking at highly viewable placements. I'm looking at fraud-free placements. But if your placement is highly viewable, but it's not brand safe, or it's highly viewable, but it's a fraudulent impression, right? Then that impression is of no use to you. So when you look at media quality, you need to look at it in totality, holistically, keeping all these four parameters in mind, and then qualify whether that impression is a quality impression for you or it's not a quality impression for you. You compromise even on one of these parameters, then probably all that dollars that you're putting in is a wastage for you. And which applies to brands' reputation as well, right? So we did a small survey with Harris Poll sometime back, where about 90% of the consumers or the respondents say that it's brands' responsibility to ensure that they appear against the right content. It's not publishers' responsibility, right? That's according to consumers. That's how they feel, right? But we as stakeholders, we believe that it's the entire ecosystem who needs to come together and ensure that the brand safety has been taken care of. And while 90% consumers say that it's brand's responsibility to appear against the brand safe content, about 67% respondents say that they would probably rethink of using the brand if they find the brand's placement in non-brand safe environment, which is a massive number, right? So consumers are getting more aware, they're getting more educated, they're responding to brand's awareness and brand's responsibility towards the society. And obviously that it's a value chain, right? And it's a snowball effect, which probably directly impacts brand equity, right? And brand equity, I don't have to tell it to anyone, right? It does impact sales volumes and profitability. And more than that, you know, we as a brand have invested millions of dollars over the years to build the reputation, right? And it can't go in vain just because, you know, some of your impressions appeared against, you know, unwanted content. So yes, it does impact. And we need to look at all the possible, you know, content pieces that are going out in different categories. And not
Divya
only
or, Divya or Vishal, would you want to add something to this? I mean, Divya, would you want to say something about this?
Completely. So there it is. I mean, we've said it earlier. Consumers are exercising their right, and rightly so, and their brand to listen and hear them and acknowledge them. So I think it's a hugely, I look at it from a positive perspective. It's very, very good for our ecosystem, our industry, where there is clear accountability and visibility.
Charles?
Yeah, I mean, see, there is no debate about this, right? I mean, the question is basically, you know, how important the entire element of, you know, being visible in the right environment for a brand. I think there is no doubt that, that's not in debate as such, right? The question is basically, how do you go about it? Now, in reality, if you look at it also, and if you take, you know, if you take the environment, irrespective, I mean, we work with a lot of multinational companies, and a lot of the MNCs basically have very clear guidelines in terms of how to go about ensuring that, you know, there's negations across multiple keywords, negations across multiple sites, negations across multiple channels, and so on and so forth. Irrespective of putting all those negations in place, there are very sophisticated ways in which the traffic can be hijacked. Yeah? If you put all the tools in place, it still can get hijacked, right? The point I'm trying to make essentially over here is that irrespective of what you do, there is the other element over here of what does the campaign do for your ROI. For the business, basically, what's the end goal that you manage to drive? And the question is, what can you do about that? And to arrive at that, essentially, you need to look at a whole lot of things, essentially. So while you put the hygienes in place, there's also a lot of stuff that you need to do on your analytics, right? So and then the interplay between brand safety measures that you currently do right now versus the kind of work that you do on your Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics, there has to be an interplay between the two so you can actually get the real true picture of how your campaign is actually done. And to me, again, it's no longer a debate about should we be focusing a little bit more on brand safety and ad fraud. I think the question over here is, how can we kind of drive better outcomes? And when we've seen that we've done and we've tracked it across the consumer journey, irrespective of the campaign, it's always been a 20% increase on the ROI that we can deliver on the campaign, right? So I think that's the way I think all marketers should start looking at it, not necessarily as a cost, but more as an investment.
You know, with so many factors, like so many things that you guys have been mentioning, what I would want to understand is that whose responsibility is it? You know, is it only a brand's responsibility to ensure media quality, or should it be shared by across the supply chain? Anyone, I mean, Ruchira or Arvind or Shriram, any one of you can answer that.
So, you know, while Vishal was talking earlier and he was talking about clients and what mandates you put out. So first of all, I'm going to deviate a little bit, Nazia, before I come back to your question. But to what Vishal was saying earlier as well, I think it's very important that you have the right metrics in place and you're measuring for the right impact. I mean, you know, this whole cost per click, I just got to go way beyond that. There was a time when we were so excited by impressions and cost per impression, right? I mean, not so long ago. Whether it's the actions taken or engagement, which is how we like to look at, you know, quality engagements, quality views. And then to your point on the supply chain has to work with you. So we will actively choose, and I'm saying we as in what we'd like to do, of course, in partnership with our agency, which is Wavemaker, what you'd actively like to do is work with partners who are delivering the right kind of metrics for you in the supply chain. Otherwise, you will choose not to work with them. So it does make a difference to them in terms of the dollars that they're able to attract. Equally, to your point, we also have other metrics. So we use other digital tracking tools to tell us that when this was on, literally day by day, week on week, right? How did your metrics move with what we call our digital tribes? You know, so as it's not just, so in an environment, of course, it's my business, where my brand go, where my advertising goes, what content I go with, the guidelines that Vishal spoke about. But equally, and of course, it's the agency's point as part as well to then, you know, double down on investing in the right kind of tools to ensure that we're cleaning up. But, you know, we're only working with people who can do that. But equally on the supply chain side, if you're not able to come back to me and share with me impact of those campaigns, I'm not going to be able to come back and, you know, invest again and again. So the other impact of COVID, which no one has really spoken about, is how precious dollars have become, right, on advertising, and how limited the inventory on digital has become. I think Hotstar was the first to sell out on IPL when it happened last season. So it was, so in that environment, even more so, it is literally a consolidated value chain that has to clean up. You know, not just a mandate from one global, earlier it used to be all about global, multinational, global brands. How do we ensure we have the right kind of, you know, brand safety parameters? So that's where we're at. And I'm happy to hear from the rest of the panel in terms of their experiences.
Sriram, do you want to add to it?
Yeah, sure. I think I agree with both of what Ruchira's points are. Right? One is about what's the measure, right? How do we, what is the objective around what we do? You know, in the past, it was all about performance measurement through clear, you know, financial metrics or business metrics like clicks, impressions, reach. I think performance measurement is still important, of course, because it's all driven around, you know, business results. But I think there are two important elements that have been added over time. One is consumer experience, and second is reputation. I think, and we talk about consumer experience. Earlier, it was all about the experience of the consumer once they reach our platforms, you know, a virtual or physical, when I call it physical for automotive, it's the dealerships. And within the virtual, it's our website, you know, it's the engagement that they have in our virtual showrooms and virtual test drives. But that's actually gone beyond to the experience we generate with them the moment they think about our brand. And it actually starts from the awareness level. Now, reputation is not just about what experience they have with our product, but what experience they have with our brand at every stage. You know, how are, what is the context of our brand setting? You know, that's important for us as well. So of course, you know, I think, so it's critical, you know, I go back to what Nachiket mentioned, Vishal, and of course, Ruchira. I think we're all saying the same things, right? But the context of advertising, especially for digital, because it's much more trackable, which is the big benefit of it, is gone from just performance measurement to consumer experience and reputation management. And we look at, you know, taking, you know, how do we manage reputation, right? Of the pre, you know, the stage when the customer is still not reaching our site. And that's through, you know, brand safety and suitability measures like viewability, right? For us, we have actually gone and we track viewability very seriously. Almost, you know, I get a report every week, and we work with our media partners to actually boycott key publishers who are not giving us the viewability rates, who are not giving us the quality that we are looking for from them. We are constantly tracking our bot traffic, of course, but that's more about performance management, right?
Have you actually boycotted someone?
Yes, we have. Yes, we have. We constantly look at, see, this is part of, you know, at the end of the day, everything boils back to business metrics, right? So if you're not actually managing reputation, it has, may not have a short-term impact tomorrow, but it has a medium-term, long-term impact on how a customer views the brand and has higher propensity to click and higher propensity to stay and experience a journey on our virtual you know, site. So extremely critical for us to really bring it back to some very measurable metrics, but go beyond what we've been doing in the past.
Nachiket, if I can bring you back into the debate, and if you can, you know, explain the difference between brand safety and suitability, because these two terms are quite interchangeable, you know. So what is the exact difference between these two terms?
So brand safety has been in play for years now, right? That's something which every brand must adopt at a basic level. So there are certain categories like, say, pornography or violence or you know, substance abuse, etc., which no brand would want to advertise on, right? That's applicable for all the brands universally. Now, come Web 2.0, with everybody, every single individual is a publisher, anybody can go out there and start their blog or start putting content. With that, a lot of other content categories emerge, right? Not all of them are probably suitable for all the brands. So as Arvind mentioned earlier, right, they are a family brand, right? They wouldn't want to advertise on content around alcohol or content around parenting, or an alcohol brand, for example, wouldn't want to advertise on parenting related content or kids content, right? But not necessarily that piece of content is harmful for other brands, right? Parenting content is suitable for marketing, and vice versa. That's where brand suitability kicked in, right? Which means that each brand has to develop their own brand safety strategies, right? There are certain ground rules which applies to everyone. But beyond that, you need to, as a brand, identify where you want to play, right? Where you can balance the reach with the scale, at the same time where you want to balance your brand safety policies or guidelines for your brand. And that's really where everybody's moving. So that they're evolving from being present on brands or avoiding brand safety categories to scaling further and add on more to brand suitability pieces of content.
So Nachiket, how have these demands changed in this last 1.5 years that we were, stuck? We all were stuck with pandemic. So, this has been a very different year. The new cycle got impacted and the strategies of brands that work with you must have, they would have asked for something different. So how did it change in last 1.5 years?
Yeah, I think it hit the brands and everybody, right, all of a sudden, and which made all the marketers take a second look at the brand safety strategies, right? Because a lot of marketers use news websites or channels or content blindly, right? Because that's the most trustworthy platform that you can go on, which can give you good quality audiences. But what happened probably in last year and a half is about 80-90% of the content was around COVID, right? And at that point of time, a lot of that content is around increasing the positivity rate in the deaths and how infrastructure has collapsed. But on the other hand, there are a lot of positive that it came out, right? Work-life balance is better now, how everybody is spending more time at home, not commuting, right? Spending time with family. So while as a marketer, I don't want to be present on COVID negative news, but I'm comfortable to be present on COVID positive sentiments or COVID positive related news. Which we started, as a technology, segregating in different categories, right? So all our COVID negative news, we started categorizing in natural disaster. But all the COVID positive news, we started categorizing in different categories depending on the kind of article or kind of content that is there. So initially, we saw a lot of brands blocking their inventory on COVID content, which slowly started opening up, which helped them achieve the scale, maintain the reach, deliver their on-target numbers for their plans, and at the same time safeguard their communication from probably not so good COVID related content.
Divya, if I can have you again in the debate, and I'm getting a lot of questions mostly for Divya. I'll start addressing them also. But first, I want to ask the generic question that, I have for you is that, what are the major challenges that advertisers face when implementing brand safety and suitability in context to Indian market?
I think first and foremost, I would still go back to what Divya said and my conversation with Sriram earlier.
I asked Divya. Sorry.
Oh, you asked Divya? Sorry. My bad.
I asked Divya.
Okay. If you please,
if you want to complete, you can complete.
Yes, please let Nachiket complete. Please.
I think quickly before Divya starts, first and foremost, I think as a brand, you need to understand that this is a hygiene for every single brand, right? And one needs to look at how you want to measure the media and whether how you want to buy the media quality and how you want to evaluate the media that you buy. If you are kind of ready to put that across as your strategy, then probably the next steps is finding the agency partner to evaluate the platform and get going.
I'm going to address this in, again, a larger context. You know, we've just recently concluded a study that indicates that the human behind the impression has returned, right? And therefore, privacy has become a human right. Context. The message to people, publishers, advertisers, agencies is very clear. Ethics, data ethics is going to become paramount in the next few years. Now, in that, with larger play at hand, all, you know, according each other mutual respect. Because what has happened, or, you know, Ruchira mentioned this, and I was smiling away, Ruchira. We have grappled with all that we are talking today, discussing today, across media all these years. And I can regale y'all with stories and stories, but that's not what we are here for. In when we did this on print, did it on TV, it's right now digital and so on. But you accord each other respect, responsibility, and accountability all in a straight line. That, to my mind, is paramount. I was again going to say hygiene. We've said hygiene enough number of times. But this, you know, and then to all my panelists, what I've heard again and again, you see, whatever metrics we follow and whatever metrics we decide are more important than the other, the point is you're in an active conversation with your consumers, right? You want to hear, you want to behave responsibility so that they behave. And the consumers holding us accountable is very, very healthy for us.
But what are the challenges that you face, you know, when you're dealing with brands? What, if you can give some example, you know, without naming a brand?
So we spoke about brand safety, brand suitability. So, and Nachiket tried to give examples. And that's the thing wherein, for example, you do have guardrails given the category that you function in, right? You do have guardrails even on the brand safety. But that often, as a marketeer, and I'm sure my fellow panelists will agree, there is a constant push and pull between wanting to scale up, go for reach, and wanting to play it safe. Right? So you, depending on the elasticity of, you want to, but you do not want to, you do not want to act irresponsibly. That, to my mind, is a perennial dilemma that all marketeers will have to grapple with. Reach, scale versus your guardrails, number one. Number two, I loved it when you know, there was a clear call out that we have actually debarred some, you know, publishers. Because what you're doing is you are walking your talk. It's all a good and great way to, you know, call for transparency and trust and all. As marketers, if we are exercising that call, I salute you. Yeah. And the third one, if I may, is when I say respecting your consumers and the ecosystem. So respecting your agency, respecting your publishers, all of that, and quid pro quo will automatically happen. So I hope I've addressed it, larger perspective.
Vishal, would you want to add some fourth or fifth point to it?
Yeah, see, I'll be very honest over here, right? If you take all the impressions that's being served in the digital industry today, and Nachiket will agree to this, basically, it's less than 10% of them are actually being monitored for brand safety and suitability and so on. Okay, there's a whole lot of 90% of the inventory that's out there that's not being done, right? I think one of the reasons for that is because, I'll be very blunt and honest over here, a lot of marketers today still see this as a line item, which is a cost item to them, right? They don't see it as a revenue item. They don't see it as an investment, rather they look at it as a cost item. And I'll be very honest over here that I think it's a failure of the entire ecosystem where we're not able to kind of show that kind of merit towards it, right? The kind of delta that we've been able to do. And like I said, basically, wherever we've been able to kind of do it, we've seen an uplift of about 10 to 20 odd percent. And I think to me, if I can be very, very honest, I think that's the real problem when we look at the barrier for adoption, right? I think there are not enough stories that are going out. There are not enough conversations around this. There are not enough case studies and kind of metrics to prove this, right? So if you go about 5 years back or rather 10 years back also, right? You look at ad serving as a concept. It was a massive difficulty to get a lot of clients to even put money on ad serving and use a third party ad server to kind of figure out or validate the kind of impression that was out there. This is probably two notches after that, right? So I think India has still a long way to go. And if I can be very, very honest, I think marketers need to start looking at this as an investment and not as a cost item. And when they start doing that and when they start constantly monitoring it and constantly be at it to kind of see results, like the way Sriram was saying that they're currently on it and they keep monitoring and they look at the viewability numbers on an ongoing basis, negate those sites and constantly evolve. I think that's when we'll actually start seeing results, if I may say so.
I'll start taking some audience questions now. I have one addressed to Divya. So this is Mr. Deepak Saxena. So, hi, I'm Deepak. I'm into TV ad sales working with Sakshi TV, a Telugu news channel. My question is to Divya, when already in media planning of TV, there is NCCS, Consumer Classification System, which ascertain the right eyeballs or audience as per brand requirement. In this robust system of media measurement, is there really further need to be cautious about media quality and brand safety?
Short answer is yes, Deepak. Of course there is. Just because you have classified by NCCS does not in any which take away from the fact that you need to have robustness and brand safety. I'm just drawing parallels. I'm sure you didn't mean the question only for TV. On digital, you do need to, like I keep saying, that is table stake hygiene. You do need to address it.
Arvind, if you can take, is Arvind there? Arvind, if you can take this next question. This is based on the latest controversy. How do we view Ronald's action 2 days back? It is not a fraud or bad intention, but impacted the company. Is there any digital parlance of such incidences? If so, how do we protect it?
Well, there isn't any caption I can come up with to describe that in the context of this particular topic, but I think it's just a case of very important and influential artist expressing her opinion or his opinion, right? And I think the brand's response also has been pretty much in the right zone, saying that everyone to their preferences. So I think in this day and age, this is something brands would keep seeing more and more. And be cautious about. You can never plan for it, but I think self-expression and authentic expression, just like brands are worried about, I think people and individual artists are also worried about.
If I can just add to that, Arvind's point, right? It's interesting to note essentially that even Cristiano Ronaldo is a brand, right? I mean, he's a brand, and the environment around him was not suitable for the other brand. If I can put that right. It's a very interesting thing.
And then build on that, really. Yes, it is about environment. So therefore, it is brand suitability at its absolute basic, right? Brand suitability into that context. But I think the bigger one is also, what's the threat? What's the risk for all of us? When something's unsuitable, the virality of the moment is what is. And I think that's one of the questions that will come up to say, what are the threats? The virality of that moment. And that means someone taking a screen grab of something that's not suitable, putting it on a social medium and it going viral, right? We've seen any number of examples of that. I think that's a big watch out. So how do you, so therefore the risk, like Vishal was saying, don't look at it as only as a cost. And I'll tell you, we are all guilty of it at some point or the other, and maybe continuing to do, which is you go for the scale and you kind of say, okay, listen, do I really want to spend money on the, you know, on the audit lines at the bottom? But that's the watch out. And for me, I mean, that was the thing, right? To say, I actually looked at it as context, the brand in it. The brand otherwise is a perfectly safe brand, but it was just the context that was wrong. And then when it goes viral, I mean, it gets interpreted in all kinds of different contexts, and that's a challenge.
Sriram, you have something to add?
Actually, I'm looking at the question for me as well, and I would like to combine the response along with what Ruchira mentioned and also what Arvind and Vishal have talked about, right? How do you measure customer experience and repetition? So customer experience, there are performance measures of, you know, bounce rates and, you know, how much engagement do they have with each and every element. You know, now we have very Adobe tools are fantastic to actually understand experience, time, engagement in our own platforms and social customer experience on engagements on social platforms is very well measured. But I think it goes a little bit more than that. It's not just the quantity, but also the quality of experience. And it actually comes back into how it's placed, where what kind of contents get generated. And that brings me back to the repetition, because it's kind of interconnected. We try to always look at binary digits of measurements, but then we kind of dig deep. Repetition measures are various, right? There is brand lift studies, there are repetitions, 5 stars and social media, you got the reputation for each and every location. All our dealers have a Google My Page, and each of them will have a star rating, and we actually get them to publish their star rating. But that's reputation after the customer's experienced our brand. But what before that, right? And that goes back to what Divya was mentioning, right? The narration and the story and the dialogue that we're having with the customer actually generates the right kind of content, and that kind of drives a better reputation overall, and that has a halo effect, which is hard to measure, but it has a halo effect on your measurable metrics. Today, most of the content, especially, coming back to post-COVID, what's changed? User-generated content. There's so much user-generated. People have a lot of time to comment on everything else, everybody else. So on one end, from a content generation, user-generated content, memes, taking something which is easy to understand and making it viral or actually translate into multiple, that's hugely happening there. On the other side, tolerance for bad content has come down significantly. And it goes back to the, metric that Nachiketa was mentioning, 90% of the customers feel that it's brand's responsibility to have the content right. The tolerance level for watching bad content has gone down significantly because they're spending more time on the digital media right now. We have seen that the video completion rates have actually gone up post-COVID.
I'm only left with 10 minutes. We have lots of questions coming in. I also have to take closing remarks. So I'll take one more question from the audiences, which can, I think Nachiket can address it. How do you track, control the context in which your brand appears? Particularly, how do you control what goes? And I think he wants to say what comes after your ad, after once your ad is already there. How do you control the content?
So you don't control the content, you control your communication, right? You can't control the content that's going out. However, you can control where your communication is appearing on, right? And there are ways and means, there are tools available like DV, right? Where it's not only the content, but the context of that page is also right? So for example, in an article, if Apple is a keyword, that Apple can be a fruit, that Apple can be an iPhone, or Apple can be a chemist nearby you, right? So does that article really make sense to you? Then you need to really look at what that really means, that keyword means. Is it talking about nutrition? Is it talking about the latest iPhone? Or is it talking about the kids near you? And then you decide whether you want your communication to appear against that content or not, right? So that's how you contextualize and read the context of that piece of content. And then you can optimize your communication. You can, in fact, stop the creative delivery, or you can completely negate delivering your ad on that piece of article. So there are means and ways to kind of tackle that. You don't have to wait till the time your communication is delivered on that content.
Before we close, I have two questions. I mean, I can club the questions because I would want each one of you to, you know, sum it up for me. One is, how can we as an industry work together to improve this trust issue and achieve greater transparency between brands and agencies? Secondly, you know, what are your hopes from the digital advertising ecosystem in India moving forward? I mean, if we can club these two questions, and if I can start from Divya, start with Divya, if you can tell me how do we, you know, work together, you know, to improve the things that are in our control.
Okay, so transparency. More important than all parts of the industry. And it leads to greater trust. So if we can, and it's easier said than done, but if we can strive towards that, and it is a constantly moving target, and it requires constant work. But if we can all strive towards that, then the entire ecosystem will become that much more healthier. And the next point I would cite is respect. I spoke about it very briefly earlier, mutual respect for our consumers, for our ecosystem. And, you know, if we do that, and with respect, obviously you can only get respect when you hold yourself accountable. That, to my mind, would be key.
Vishal?
Yeah, I kind of agree. When you look at it, right, our ecosystem consists of multiple players, right? So there are the publishers, there are the advertisers, there are agencies, there's tech partners, and so on and so forth. And I think when you talk about respect and transparency, it has to be across all the people who are connected in the entire ecosystem. And the challenge is basically when you look at fraud and, you know, viewability to a large extent also, the publishers tends to kind of gain from it. Let's be honest about it, okay? And as a result of which, it's very difficult, and that's the reason why the industry has not seen a solution for so many years, right? Or for the longest time. My genuine belief, right? And I've been doing a lot of research on this, and I honestly feel that one way to solve this problem, and I think 7 days back also, to my to my belief, basically there was a report which was published by Ernst & Young, which talked about how blockchain can at least be the kind of solution to this, right? Because it looks at standardization across all the three, all the ecosystem, all the partners across the journey. And it looks at standardization also of identity across each part elements, basically. And that's where, you can bring in the element of trust and respect and transparency, basically. And I think to me and my hope is basically that we will move towards an industry where we can implement a solution of this manner, where there is some level of standardization that can translate into respect and transparency.
Ruchira, would you want to start?
After two industry heavyweights, you're making me go next. I think like Vishal and Divya said, transparency, let's have the uncomfortable conversations. Let's be honest. Vishal, you quoted a number on bots, right? Who talks about it when you make a media plan? Let's be honest about the fact that this is what you've got. We need to go up against it. Sometimes, and I'm not one for making bodies and legislations and everything, but look what's happened with the paid tag for influencer advertising. Suddenly, you're going to find a completely different universe, right, operating over there. In a sense, we need to do the same thing here, which is to actually call out, and maybe it needs body, maybe it needs the coming together of, you know, big, heavyweights in the media industry, including, for example, a forum like yours, to say, this is what you should do. Because otherwise, the medium itself goes down the tube, right? So I think that's one big thing. To your point on what do I have to look forward to? A lot. There's a lot of innovation coming in here. I mean, I'm looking forward to shoppable content. I'm looking forward to content integrations and into how I can market more accurately to people who really want to hear my message. I don't want to talk to people who are not interested and who are going to mute the damn thing, you know, during a program and then walk out of the room, right? That's wasted media. So I'm looking forward to that, because that can drive, it can be good for small brands, it can be good for big brands. I mean, everyone benefits from that universe. So there's a lot to look forward to, but we need to have the honest conversation first. Otherwise, you're going to be condemning this whole, you know, and every time you have a conversation with someone, they'll say, yeah, you know, great, great reach on a campaign, but yeah, they're all those problems. And that's the kind of conversation you typically have. So, yeah.
Arvind?
Well, I think it's a time for, you know, much more transparency. I would say for me, that's the theme. And given the trust, you know, consumers, brands, agencies, publishers, etc., have kind of placed on this medium. They all have placed a huge bet on the medium, right? And rightly so. But I think it's a need for, there's a need for transparency in terms of metrics, in terms of who you are serving the ad to, and so on and so forth. And just connecting it to one of the questions you asked earlier, you know, Nazia, I would say while the ecosystem has the responsibility, everyone in the ecosystem have a responsibility, much of it starts with the marketeers asking the right questions, right? So, you know, if you look at the latest tools and techniques that are needed to do the right thing in the space in terms of measurement, control ad fraud, less than 10% of marketeers use those tools and techniques, right? Which means we have a long, long way to go. So marketeers, the onus is on marketeers to ask the right questions, which means they need to be updated on the top topic, and they ask the partners the right questions, and then the whole kind of chain moves in that direction. I think that's where I would put the onus, and of course, then the ecosystem have to be equipped to kind of give the right answers, you know, from a perspective of transparency. I think that's very important. Else, very soon, there would be questions on ROI. And if there is any doubt on those ROIs, the faith in digital as a medium, there is a risk that it's shaken.
Sriram.
I would just say the same things that everybody has said. I think number one, asking the right questions as a marketer, you know, absolutely, Arvind, very few actually look at digital as ATL. You know, we're still kind of talking to, you know, these are the five different mediums and hey, digital. It is actually more precision marketing through a very combined way of communicating. And it is not creative, which is driving, actually it's data and audience, which is driving our communication plan. So data becomes important for us. Education around how this digital ecosystem works is critical, number one. Number two, like Divya mentioned and Ruchira mentioned as well, it's about conversations with the publishers, really understanding the key parameters, having constant reports and reviews to be able to track and take corrective actions. And third is, I think, more importantly, self-regulation. I think from a publisher's perspective, I see that happening in OTTs right now. Self-regulation is also very important. And I think that's a responsibility and accountability that most of us have to enforce or take on ourselves to make sure that, you know, we're delivering the best content for the consumer. At the end of the day, the consumer is the winner, right? I mean, they are the ones who give us the bread and butter. So if they are not happy, we are not happy. That's a reality that we need to address.
Nachiketa, if you can give us some final solutions and, you know, what should be the way forward?
I think all of us have spoken about it, right? There is nothing beyond this, right? It starts with asking hard questions, making all the stakeholders accountable, right? We as a marketers, so we at WWF believe that marketers, they have the fundamental right to get clean media, right? If they're buying and paying for impression, that needs to be a quality impression, right? Nobody wants to pay for a fraudulent impression or a non-brand safe impression or an unviewable impression, right? We all want quality media. So it needs to be a fundamental right, and it needs to be measured, and it needs to be reported. And if it's not being measured, then I think that should be the first step, right? That should be the first step for any digital strategy, because if you're not qualifying the audiences, then all the dollars that you have spent on building digital experiences, CRM, personalization, advocacy, probably will go for a toss because you're not getting the right footfall in first place on your web assets. So we probably educate, and that's where we talk to clients, saying that you start with quality media, evaluating media, And I agree with Sriram, right? You need to ask hard questions and make publishers, agencies, as well as players like us accountable and answerable for everything that's getting reported and act on it. And to deliver better ROI, you know, the quality inventory is a must, right? Quality impression is a must. And probably that's where we can all start with asking the right questions and evaluating the media that we're buying.
I would request Michelle if we can email these questions. There are a lot of questions that have come into all of you, and if you can take out a few minutes to respond, you know, over the email, and we can give the answers to our viewers. So, because right now we are completely out of time, we've already exceeded 2 minutes, and I think we had only asked you for your 1 hour, so we'll not stretch it beyond. Thank you very much for joining. I hope you all are more transparent with each other going forward. I mean, that's what I've understood, that, you know, you all need to be transparent with each other and with us also. So thank you again for joining and for all the insight. And this panel was brought to you by E4M, with association with Double Verify. And I hope to see you all again soon. Thank you very much. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Nazia.
Thank you, everyone. Take care.
Take care.